Welcome to the world, no heroes and villains. Welcome to the war, we've only begun. So pick up your weapon and face it. There's blood on the ground, go and take it. You get one shot to make it out alive. So higher and higher you chase it. It's deep in your bones, go and take it. This is your moment. Now is your time, so prove yourself and rise, make them remember you. Push through heaven, rise, they will remember you. Welcome to the climb, reach for the summit. Pray the one falls steadily the end. So higher and higher you chase it. It's deep in your blood, go and take it. This is your moment. Take to the skies, go. Prove yourself and
it is, what it isn't. Looking for a better way to get up out of bed instead of getting on the internet and checking a new hit. Me get up, first shot, come strut walking. A little bit of humble, a little bit of cautious. Somewhere between like Rocky and Cosby's for the game. Nope, nope, y'all can't copy yet. Bad moonwalking, and this here is our party. My posse's been on Broadway, and we did it all way. Chrome music, I shed my skin and put my bones into everything I record to it. And yeah, I'm on. Let that stage light go and shine on down. That Bob Barker suit game and Plinko in my style. Money, stay on my craft and stick around for those pounds. But I do that to pass the torch and put on for my town. Trust me, on my I-N-D-E-P-E-N-D-E-N-T. It's hustling, chasing dreams since I was 14 with the four-track busting. Halfway across that city with the back. Crush it, labels out here, now they can't tell me nothing. We give that to the people, spread it across the country. Labels out here, now they can't tell me nothing. We give it to the people, spread it across the country.
Can we go back? This is the moment. Tonight is the night. We'll fight till it's over. So we put our hands up like the ceiling can't hold us. Like the ceiling can't hold us.
Can we go back?
I'm so damn grateful. I grew up really wanting gold fronts, but that's what you get when Wu-Tang raised you. Y'all can't stop me. Go hard like I got an 808 in my heartbeat. And I'm eating at the beat like it gave a little speed to a great white shark on shark. We raw. Time to go off. Gone. Deuces goodbye. I got a world to see. And my girl, she wanna see Rome. Caesar make you a believer. Nah, I never ever did it for a throne. That validation comes from giving it back to the people. Now sing this song and it goes like, raise those hands. This is our party. We came here to live life like nobody was watching. I got my city right behind me. If I fall, they got me. Learn from that failure, gain humility, and then we keep marching.
And we go back. This is the moment. Tonight is the night. We'll fight till it's over. So we put our hands up like the ceiling can't hold us. Like the ceiling can't hold us.
We go back.
This is the moment. Tonight is the night. We'll fight till it's over. So we put our hands up like the ceiling can't hold us. Like the ceiling can't hold us.
Oh.
Hello and welcome back to the Rekt League. We have a very exciting game in front of us between Team Infernal and Team Mountain Drake. I'm Darth Ted, your host, joined here with my co-caster, Endo. How you doing tonight?
I'm doing great, Darth Ted. I'm so excited for tonight's games. We have a lot on the line for both teams. One's going to be fighting for their second place position, while the other is going to be trying to slide in that last playoff slot as the season comes to the end. So I just can't wait to get started.
Yeah, me neither. And since we don't actually have to wait for any players, since this is a recap, we can just get straight into it.
Easy peasy, just like that. Let's do it.
All right, so first we're just going to go over picks and bans really quick. So we don't have the actual order of the picks and bans, but we'll just display them on the screen to let you guys know what happened in Champ Select. So what do you think about these two team comps coming out?
Wow, so that's actually really great from the top lane. First thing that pops out to me is just that aggression that we're seeing on both Infernal and Mountain. Kled and Renekton are two snowballing champions that want to kick butt right away. So I'm excited to see how that plays out.
Oh, actually, that is a mistake. That is game two. So a little sneak peek for you guys in the next game.
Little spoilers, all right.
Little spoilers. Let me just fix that right now and transition. Here we go. There we go. That should be better.
All right, here we go. So on Mountain side, first champion that's going to pop out to me is Unstream's Nocturne. He's been having a lot of success with that in the league, and it's going to be nice just to see if he's able to take that champion and really utilize the ult that we had talked about a lot during our last cast.
Yeah, Nocturne is a super scary pick right now, and once you get a little bit of damage on him and hit level 6, you can just one-shot pretty much everyone on the other team other than that Malphite.
Yeah, absolutely. That Malphite's going to be the only tank line. I believe that's going to be Toxic Pheasant on that. So we'll see if he's going to go for that AP Malphite and just blow everyone up with his ultimate, or if he's going to try and be using that armor passive that Malphite has and be more of a front line.
Yeah, so what do you think about the Kayn early on into this Nocturne?
So Kayn, I think, is a good choice here because Kayn is similar to Nocturne, where you're not looking for that early game aggression. Kayn only comes online when he changes forms, and Nocturne only comes online when he turns level 6. So this matchup, they actually are both playing for the late game, and it's going to help both of them get to the point they need to be to take over the game as strong jungler champions.
That is a really good point. And then I guess we can just bring it back over to the mid lane now. The Malzahar versus Ahri. I think we've seen this a couple of times.
Yeah, we have been seeing this matchup a lot. What are your thoughts on it?
So it really does kind of seem like a skill matchup between the two. And Malzahar should be able to shove the Ahri in after he levels up his abilities a little bit. And then Ahri's going to have a hard time finding that roam, which she really wants to do.
Yeah, absolutely. I don't know if you're going to want to, like you said, the Ahri's strength is moving all over the map, but with Malzahar's pushing power, it kind of keeps her stuck in lane. So we'll see if who's going to be able to get the advantage there. Yeah, and as the ADC and bot lane genius, what are you thinking about the Jhin versus Kai'Sa matchup?
So in the bot lane, I really like to talk about both champs together. So the Jhin Sona into the Kai'Sa Morgana should be very, very good for the first couple of levels, but that has the caveat of if Morgana can land a binding, then Kai'Sa is just going to have so much damage on the Jhin or the Sona, either or, just because they're both very immobile champions.
Yeah, and I believe Sona's actually has the lowest HP out of all these supports, if I remember that correctly. Yeah, so yeah, one snare and Sona could just get blown up, but they do have that poke, and you got to bully Kai'Sa in the beginning, right? Because otherwise she just turns on and there's no shutting her off.
Yeah, and again, we see another lane that has some really, really good gank set up for this Nocturne. And
oh, I mean, man. You hit that snare and you know Nocturne is screaming in to finish the kill.
Exactly. And we've seen Sonic MNA on this Kai'Sa before, and I mean, he just looks like a monster on it. So we'll have to see if Infernal can shut these picks down.
For sure. I mean, Kai'Sa definitely fits Sonic's playstyle. Sonic is definitely more of a farm early and then become a large champ later in the game. And with Kai'Sa, when she gets that second item, it's lights out for the other team. So I could definitely see why Sonic enjoys this pick so much.
Yeah. And not to sleep on Coolio's Jhin, though. I mean, Coolio has shown himself to be an extremely good player, farming up. And I think his CSD right now is, I think, plus 12 CS against his opponents, which as an average is really, really strong.
Yeah, yeah. And that's going against other ADCs too. And, you know, I know you ADCs, you love your farm. So that's actually pretty impressive.
All right. And I think we'll just go straight into the game from that.
Sounds good. I actually have the game preloaded, so I'm ready to start when you are.
Yep. I will give you a 3-2-1 and start on that.
Sounds good.
Ready? 3-2-1 start. And we see some penguins coming out right off the beginning for Team Infernal. Looking good.
So we have, do you think is going to be the lane to watch early?
So honestly, top lane, I'm expecting Toxic Vezin to be shoved up pretty hard by this Urgot. I think Urgot is a super strong pick right now and just will bully the crap out of this Malphite. So unless Zabel can do something to turn that lane, probably nothing's going to happen there. And mid lane is just going to be a farm fest as well. So bot lane's probably the lane to watch.
Yeah, yeah, I totally agree with that sentiment there. Urgot is just such a bully early on. Hopefully Toxic Pheasant's going to be able to get some defenses up early just so he doesn't get, like, Urgot's a tower diving champion, especially with his W shield. So hopefully Toxic can get that CS that he needs to become a bit tankier and hard to punish.
Yeah, it looks like we got a couple of pings coming down, but I think it's mainly just telling each other just to back off, and they don't really think that the enemy jungler is starting topside.
Yeah, and both of them have warded, both sides have warded that bottom pixel brush, which in today's jungle meta is so important. You want to be able to find out which scuttle that your enemy jungler is taking, and you can build your path around that. Especially with two weaker early game champions like Kane and Nocturne, the more information you have on where the enemy jungler is, the better you are.
Yeah, and it looks like Kane is going straight for the spot side scuttle after clearing out the red and his Wraith camp.
Yeah, and it's the smart choice because with the bot side, his clear is healthier than Nocturne, and he has the red buff, so if it does go to a one-on-one, he will win that solely on buff and HP alone.
Yeah, and they actually do see him out on that ward, so they know Kane is in the bot side jungle.
And on bot side, we already see Coolio and Timberland getting stuck under the turret a little bit.
Yeah, but the gank is coming in from Zabel. He gets the red slowdown. Root comes up from the Jhin W. A lot of damage onto Sonic. Heal and Flash Blown. And nice. Oh, first blood going over to the red buff. Timberland with... Oh, Flash out from Rovian. Trying to go on Zabel, but doesn't have enough damage.
Yeah, and that little heal there from Timberland's going to keep him alive from the Ignite. Great snare by Coolio. That was just brilliantly played by both sides. That snare was so close to saving Sonic MNA, but just barely not enough. And that's huge for Kane to get this lead in the early game.
Yeah, that is really, really big for this Kane. But we do see him going straight back to that Krug camp, though, which gives Unstrained full leave to invade this topside jungle. So he should be able to 3-buff Kane right here.
Yeah, he's putting down the safety ward. He's going to try and drag that blue sentinel out towards the river for a little bit more safety. Yeah, I think you're right. I think he's going to be able to three buff him. Good heads up play by on stream, getting the second scuttle and stealing a buff to try and even out the lead that Kane currently has. And in top lane, let's take a look here. We already see that the Urgot is bullying the Malphite. It has double the CS, which is something that we had expected with this matchup.
Yeah, it doesn't look too good for Toxic Vezin. Yeah, at first, it looked like he got shoved in by Radizee pretty early and was just too afraid to step up to the caster minions to get any of that CS and just let it all die to the tower.
Yeah, I mean, Radizee can be a bit of a lane bully. Usually he likes a Scion pick, so that I'm assuming was banned. So they just he just moved on to the next bully, which is Urgot. But I think Toxic is doing his job here, right? All he has to do is just stay relevant. Don't give up too many kills to Radizee, and he's going to play his role.
Exactly. Not fall too far behind and just be that engaged tool that Infernal needs to win fights.
We see Zabel sitting here looking for that. Oh, the ward spots him out. Good heads up play by Radizee. And good adjustment on knowing the jungler too, because most people try and put a ward in the brush to spot the ganks, but since Kane can walk through walls, Raddy's thinking, nah, not falling for that.
He's still there, and he's going for it.
Master Curse strikes again.
Yeah, and Urgot goes in, gets the flip over on the Malphite, and the fear comes out from the Nocturne. Malphite is in a bad space, doesn't have his flash up, and they're going to give this kill over to Unstreen.
What a great flip by Radizee. That is one of the hardest skill shots to land in the game. It just takes so long for it to load and is so predictable that it's hard to time it. But with the confusion of the fight going on, Radizee is able to flip Toxic over his shoulder and just serve up dinner for the Nocturne.
Yeah, that was really good pathing by Unstream. After seeing Zabel on the ward, he went straight topside just to make sure that his top lane was going to be okay to shove in that turret. And then as soon as he got there, Zabel goes in for a gank. So a little bit mistimed on that.
Yeah, really nice heads up play. Good communication between the two teams. And this looks like it's going to be a great jungle matchup. This game may come down to Unstreen and Zabel if we can get more ahead.
And actually in the bot lane, with that first kill going over onto Sonic, it looks like the Jhin and Sona have been able to keep their lead and pressure this Kai'Sa down.
Yeah, Kai'Sa's HP is really low, and just judging by Timberland's lack of mana, I'm sure he's just been poking the hell out of him to really drive that point home.
Yeah, and we also just missed an ultimate come down from Private Sparkle in the mid lane. Looks like D-Fox stepped up a little bit too far and had to ult away.
Yeah, this is an interesting substitution, actually, for Infernal Drake. Last time Private Sparkle was their ADC, he's been moved to the mid lane. He's not doing too bad. He's just down 6 CS, which is fine if you're going for a tier build. You're not expected to bully out your enemy mid laner. It's an interesting choice to sub an ADC to the mid lane, but it seems to be working out.
Oh, this does not look good for Toxic in the top lane. There are 5 caster minions right here coming up to this next wave. Radizee is going to be able to freeze us in a really bad spot if he wants to.
Yeah, actually here I would like to see him a little bit more aggressive. He does still have the passive up. And the way that Malphite works, when you have your armor passive, which is that gray part of the health bar, you need to go in and trade. That's your free get out of jail free card to say I can trade damage with you because mine's going to regenerate real quick.
But we do see Unstream hitting level 6 off of that early kill, and he's posturing on this bot side. Binding misses onto the Sona, so they don't go in on this.
Yeah, he is playing it patient, though. I mean, Timberland is way far up right now.
But we got Zabel coming in. This guy is going really hard. Gets the slowdown on the Kai'Sa, but she has to flash away from this. He holds onto Rovian. Rovian flashes under tower, so ends up they just have to back away from it.
And again, the junglers are just crashing heads. They're both at the right place at the right time. I like the play that Rovian had tried doing. When Kane ults inside you, he had flashed to go under the tower to hopefully catch him underneath, take a couple power shots. But I just guess Zabel had seen that coming and exited the ult a little bit early.
Yeah, it was a really good counter gank coming out because that at first looked very, very good for Unstream. But overall, Unstream was able to blow 3 summoner spells from the bot lane And I guess Kane blew three summoner spells as well, so very even trade zone there.
Look at that. They're 2 CS apart. They're the same level, and they both have one kill. It's just the clash of the titans in the jungle. The rumble in the jungle going on right now in this matchup.
Yeah, the biggest thing to talk about, though, is the CS discrepancies in the top lane. That's 40 CS going in favor of Red EZ. And he's just bullying this Malphite. Walking up, auto-attacking the turret, just trying to take it as fast as he can.
Yeah, I think Toxic needs to practice a little bit of CSing on the turret. He's aggroing just a little bit too much, so then the tower shots come awkwardly, and he's not able to secure it. I mean, again, the good news for Toxic, though, is Malphite's a champion that he's almost like Malzahar, where you just need your ult to be relevant, right?
Oof. Spicy invade coming out from the Kane, going over that Baron pit wall. He's going to... Oh, nope. Unstream is not coming over towards us, so this should just be a free red buff for Zabel.
Yeah, really aggressive, but I love the choice here. This is great. And Unstream walks in. He actually queued, expecting the red buff to be there, and he's waiting in the bush for him.
Yeah. Zabel knows that his top lane doesn't have any pressure, though, so he can't actually stay and try for any fights.
And that's where that CS difference, that bullying in the top lane comes into play, right?
Nice finding in the bot lane, though. Sona getting snared up. Good ultimate down onto both Sonic and Rovian. Sonic is stepping up, taking a lot of damage from this Jhin. Jhin flashes in, gets the last auto attack down, and now Rovian's in a bad spot. Both of them very slow, but the Sona is healing up Jhin perfectly. And that's a double kill.
Double kill goes over to Coolio. He's really taking advantage of Jin's early bullying with the fourth shot, and Kai'Sa just taking a little bit too long to come online. They're really trying to win this game early and get the lead. So later on the game, when, as I say that, shutdown goes in.
And Nocturne comes in with the ultimate, picks up an easy double kill. Looks like Coolio and Timberland were a little too greedy there, staying to try to push in that lane.
You know, that's the threat of the Unstream's Nocturne. You never know when he's just hiding in the corners waiting to eat you up. Goes ahead and does that, brings the gold back to even for the team. And 3-0 Nocturne is nothing to joke around about. He's going to be able to get his Duskblade early and just start nuking people more than he is right now.
Yeah, and one thing we actually missed was a kill onto the Ahri from Private Sparkle. It looks like he just flash ignited and ulted the Ahri. She ended up going down.
Yeah, that Malzahar, I had totally missed that. That's actually great. That Malzahar flash timer is something you need to be aware of all the time, because he can 100-0 you. Especially shocking to see. I mean, like I said earlier, Sparkles is an ADC. What's he doing winning these one-on-ones against D-Fox? He has no right for that.
I mean, Malzahar is just a super strong champion in the Rekt League. We all know this. We've all played against it.
Fair enough. He is one of the most banned champions. I believe it's him and Aurelia, who is just the bane of Rekt League right now.
It looks like D-Fox has come down for a roam onto the bot lane, but it was spotted out by a couple of wards. She ends up clearing that pink out of the tribe, but now Malzahar is roaming down as well. Everyone seems to be backing away, though. Going back to the lanes and trying to farm up.
Yep, and this is the right play by D-Fox in general. And oh, look at top lane, though, before I even get into that. Ratty Z is just going to town.
Yeah, this Urgot is going to be scary. 60 CS up over Toxic Vezin. Does not look good for this top laner.
Jeez, that's the equivalent of killing him twice in lane. He's got 100 CS at 12 minutes. Basically, with the first tower blood, basically is 2-0-1. Urgot's going to be tough to bring down. Yeah.
Going back to the bot lane, though, both junglers are posturing around here. Nocturne goes in, gets onto the Jhin, tops him. The Kane is going onto Sonic. The Kai'Sa is under turret, should stay alive from this, has the ult up, is able to use it. And then a couple of turret shots take out Zabel.
And... smart play by Sonic there. Again, like I said earlier, having when you Kane is going inside you just run under your turret. That's a great adjustment, and then he's able to get snared, take a couple turret shots, and we have a 5-0 Nocturne Dark Dead.
Yeah, that is absolutely crazy. But one more thing happened during that fight. The Sona was trying to get away under tower, and Ahri walked in, got teleported into the spot lane, and they just straight up killed her. So ended up being three deaths.
Reefer O. It's allowing Sonic some, to buy some time for Sonic to get this Kai'Sa online, because she was definitely struggling in lane. But, it looks like Coolio's a little upset about it. He's trying to charge down Sonic, but I don't know if he's going to be able to get her.
Yeah, it doesn't look like it. But with that Ahri roam, Private Sparkle was able to put on a lot of damage onto the mid lane turret. It's at 450 health right now, so that should be able to go down if they can pressure a wave or two in it.
Yeah, so we definitely see Mount and Drake starting to pull a little bit of a lead here. They've got the gold on all the right champions. And this Detoxic Vest getting charmed in mid lane has to flash out.
Yeah, I think the flash was the right call there, because you did see the Aragon. He does have ultimate up.
Yeah. I mean, I think Malphite maybe could have ulted out instead of flash, but hey, at least he's safe.
I mean, you're all gathered. Oh, Zabel's in a bad spot right now. Gets ignited. Doesn't end up burning down, though. Urgot looks like he wants to go. Nocturne goes in on him. Gets the kill with that ultimate. And now Jin's just left out. Sona is binded up. Ahri's going and gets the kill. The Malphite's feared up because of the Urgot ult. And Urgot ends up picking a triple kill.
That ult from Unstream was 100% a flex play. I told you that these junglers were butting heads all the time. He's just trying to flex on Zabel, get some of that domination, get inside his head. I love it. Balls to the wall, dives in, doesn't even care, and then the rest of Mount is able to clean up.
Yeah, and remember that Urgot with a 60 CS lead? Now he has three kills on top of that.
Double the CS, three kills. This is going to be a chunky, chunky crab.
Yeah, and they're just pressuring down mid turret right now with three, while the other two are on this Rift Herald. But Toxic Pheasant does TP in, does see it. Zabel is there as well, gets binded up, is trying to fight Rovian and Unstream. Unstream's really low, flashes out, but the ult is on from Zabel. Spell Shield comes down, but doesn't block anything. But Zabel trades his life for the jungler. Sona ult goes on to Kai'Sa. She gets silenced up, so she can't ult right now. But that's gone. Ignite going down on Toxic Pheasant. Meanwhile, Coolio just isn't here. He was farming wraiths at that time.
Yeah, I think if Coolio's there, they just win that fight decisively, especially with his ult there. That's huge shutdown goal.
Oh my god. Coolio flashes forward with the last auto attack, cues onto Kai'Sa, and does half her health and kills her.
I have never seen a Jhin flash so aggressively. Here comes the curtain call from Coolio.
Doesn't bend that last bullet around the Morgana though, so Radiz does stay alive.
This game has been complete chaos. So the good news though, so Mount and Drake is currently ahead, but the good news for Infernal is they just have the much stronger team fight, right? You basically have every single character has a way to lock down the enemy mounted drakes, right? The Sona ult, the Malphite ult. You have Malzahar locking down the carries, then the curtain call from Jhin. They just synergize so nicely that if they can get into the right position for a team fight, Infernal is definitely still in this game.
Yeah, but the problem is they need a front line, and Malphite is not farming well. It doesn't have a first item completed. It's going to take him a while to actually get to that tanky point where he can walk up and ult.
Yep. I think for now, he's just going to have to, like, play Suicide Malphite. That's it. Just hope that the team can carry. I'm actually going to be interested, too, to see which version of Kane. Or did he already transform?
Yeah, I think he's Red Kane.
That's Blue Kane.
That's Blue Kane?
Yep. He's going Blue Kane. He's going for that style. He just wants to get in the back line and blow everyone up.
They change the skins all the time.
Yeah, with the Odyssey skins, a little tougher to find out. Yep, and there's that blow up. He's on Sonic.
He's on Sonic, doesn't end up getting the kill, but unfortunately a fight happened on the other front as well. So while Zabel wasn't there, Timberland gets caught out, and Toxic Vegeta dies trying to save him.
Timberland got caught out, he still had his ultimate up, and Sonic MNA survived on the Kai'Sa with like 10 HP from Zabel trying to nuke him down.
Yeah,
just,
but the,
just a hair off.
The vision control from Mountain in this bot side river is so oppressive. It was very hard for anyone on Infernal to step up without getting caught out.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. That's and that's what's really letting them to win these fights, because Kane wants to sneak up behind the walls, but if you see him coming, it's easier to react. And they take the mid lane turret, and now they're going for the rift turret.
Yeah, and Sona, don't step up again. This is not something you want to do. Mousehard does have the spell shield, so he's safe for one spell, although Morgana W takes that off. Rift Herald is down to 1,000 HP, but it doesn't look like Infernal's going to fight for it. It just goes over downstream.
Yeah, we need to see Toxic complete an item on the Malphite. I think you hit the nail on the head here. He's still just a little bit too squishy, and with Zabel going blue cane, I mean, there's just no front line right now for Infernal.
Yeah. So what are your thoughts on going blue cane versus red cane in this game? You already know you're behind on this.
Yeah, I think Red Kane is the play here, especially with a fed Urgot. Red Kane does percent HP damage, and that's what you're gonna. And it has a lot better peel. So you have the immobile ADC on Coolio. You have Malzahar, who's not mobile at all, right? So you need the knockups. You need a way to front line and allow your teammates to carry. I think Zabel is just so aggressive and likes the style so much, and that's why he went on the blue cane. I personally would have gone red.
Fair enough. And also, it kind of seems like a arms race between the cane and the Nocturne. Who can get on and kill the enemy ADC first?
Yeah, exactly. And you're never going to beat a Nocturne to your target. His ult, especially when he gets to... now that he's level 12, he's got the second point to his ult. His distance is just getting larger and larger. I don't care how many walls you run through, Nocturne's getting there first.
So it looks like a five-man group up in the mid lane. Rift Herald is summoned for this. Nocturne goes in after Malzahar gets binded up, but it is under the turret, taking aggro. Shelly comes in, does a lot of damage to that turret. Ahri gets rooted up from the Djinn. Toxic Pheasant is under tower, gets ulted up by the Urgot. Fear goes off, but meanwhile, Kai'Sa was under turret and ends up going down. Urgot chases down the Kane, though, and is able to pick up that kill. So overall, a 3-for-2 in favor of Team Mountain.
Yeah, and there's that just that go-ahead button from Unstream. Goes ahead and just nukes the second they call it. Nice flash by D-Fox.
Oh, and Coolio goes down, the most fed member on the team, so it's going to be really hard for Team Infernal coming back from this game.
Yeah, it's get. I mean, they got a 7k gold lead right now. They're up 4 towers to 1. Mountain's really pushing their advantage against Infernal. And it's tough. I mean, Infernal really fighting for their playoff lives with this game.
Yeah. It is in jeopardy, which is unfortunate. But one thing they do have going for them is that Malphite, right? I don't care how squishy he is. If the enemy team groups up and tries to do Baron, all you need is just ult on them. And then you pretty much win the team fight.
Yeah, I think that's actually a brilliant game plan. You almost want the enemy team to do ult, because with the or to do Baron, because with Sona stunning the whole team, just serving up a Malphite ult just like that, and you can win back real quick. The only issue, though, is when you kill the squishy carries, whose job is it to kill the Urgot? He's got a Guardian Angel right now.
Oh, and Nocturne's going in on Kane. He gets blown up, ends up holding into Unstream, but Unstream's in the middle of his team, so Zabel's not able to get away. Sonic M&A picking up that kill.
Yeah, and I mean, even the Black Shield from Rovian is going to help against the ult, because Blue Kane does mixed damage with his ultimate, and that's just make sure I'm just going to be able to do this. But we're going to see if Infernal's going to be able to answer this, or they're just going to just give it up.
Yeah, and it looks like they're not even going to try to stop this with their jungler dead. They've been losing every other team fight, so this is one they don't want to pick up. And yeah. Baron going over Team Mountain.
Baron at 23 minutes to Team Mountain. I would like to see like a rotation, maybe at least take bottom turret, try and do something instead of just running backwards and hiding. It's getting to the point we're going to have to start making some big rotations, some brave moves. Otherwise, you're just going to slowly bleed out a loss.
Yeah. I mean, Coolio has been farming up, though, and is at almost 200 CS in 23 minutes, which is really good. But then again, the Nocturne already has almost three items completed, and literally one-shots him every time his ultimate is up. So, as his AD carry, you really, really need to buy a GA if you want to do anything in teamfights.
Yeah, I think that's going to be the right adjustment there. Even, what do you think about even going stopwatch before the rest of the GA?
That's probably a good call. It's probably just, the just right call.
Survive with just one unstream ult, right?
And hey, one teamfight can change the game. But he ends up getting 1,300 gold and spends on the DF sword instead, trying to take his chances.
Which isn't the wrong call. Anytime you can afford a BF sword, you gotta go for it.
And the nice thing about Jhin is you can really stay at range for this Malphite Sona combo just because your ultimate will put out so much damage to whatever target they try to go on.
Yeah, agreed. And I mean, like, their team comp is just brilliant because look how far ahead Mountain is right now. They're still wary to step up and take this tower. They're just too scared of the all-in.
Huge charm come down on Toxic Vez, and D-Fox putting a lot of damage onto this Malphite.
Yep, 25 minutes into the game, still no item for the no completed item. Oh, as I say that, he finishes the Sunfire Cape, and now he's got to worry about getting MR against that that charm combo from Ahri.
Yeah, and it's just you're supposed to be the tank line for your team, and you're super far behind. It's not a fun game for Toxic.
Yeah, it's tough. I mean, going against that lane bully Urgot, he's just so strong in this meta.
Oh yeah,
look at Unstream just walking right up.
He doesn't care. I mean, 7-0 Urgot. He's got nothing to fear from this team.
Sonic. Radice's huge. Unstream's huge. What were you gonna say?
Sonic landed a W onto Timberland. And there's the Q from Rovian. Heal has to come down to save him. And he has to flash out of that. A lot of poke. And this Sona is also really squishy at this point in the game.
Yeah, that... I mean, when even the Morgana is able to nuke you down with her pool, you know you're just a little bit far behind in the game.
Yeah, oh. And now with two inhibitors down, you don't think they're going to be able to come back in this game. They should have at least tried for a fight on one when a mountain was split up 2v3.
Yeah, I definitely agree with that call. When you still have one of the turrets up, you gotta just press the go button, right? Or else, like, it's what we were talking about before. It's just gonna be a slow bleed to a long loss. And these kind of losses can be draining, and it can definitely affect the game too.
Yeah, and they were down, what, 9k gold before those two turrets went down at 23 minutes. So, yeah, I mean, you're gonna lose this game if you don't try something. And that was your moment.
Yeah. I definitely want to see just one big hurrah, one big team fight. Let's get Infernal back into this game. I want to see Private Sparkle locking down the Nocturne when he ults in. I want to see that Sona Malphite combo, which just could be so delicious if it's done correctly. And let's get some shutdowns, because with the shutdown mechanic, you can get you can have comebacks a lot easier in the game now.
Yeah, and with his blue cane, a couple more items on him, and he'll be able to one-shot just as effectively as the Nocturne is.
Yeah, so we're going to see how they play out. Here's another turret. This has got to be another. Oh, the cane's not there right now. The snare goes down on Private Spark. He's going to have to back out.
Yeah, and Nocturne just ends up going in, able to finish up Private Sparkle. Jhin ult comes down, but Ratty Z is in front of everybody, just banking up those bullets. And Malphite gets charmed up and ends up dying to the Kai'Sa. And now you got two members dead on the side of Infernal. Super minions in the mid lane, clearing out these turrets. I think this is just game for Mountain.
Yeah, it's such a shame too, because they actually landed that Sona Malphite combo. And you saw how low Unstream got, but he's just too far ahead in this game. And he was able to survive the entire long run.
Yeah, but even at this point, if you use that combo, it can't be on Unstream, because you have a Kai'Sa to worry about, and she has two items completed. She's going to be doing so much damage if you don't get on top of her.
Yeah, agreed. You basically blow your load on downstream, and now you've got four members and no abilities.
But they look like they are defending. Zabel is flashing and goes onto the Urga, but he's got a bunch of shields and a heal coming out. Doesn't even pop the first shield. D-Fox goes in with the ultimate, ends up getting a kill. Meanwhile, on the top side, Malzahar ends up picking up one onto the Kai'Sa. But this fight just doesn't look good. Urgot's in the middle of everyone. Toxic has to flash away from the fear. And meanwhile, Unstream is just taking the Nexus with these super minions.
What a performance by Mountain Drake. Ready Z just too chunky, throughout that entire fight. He didn't even pop his GA. Unstream way too far ahead and just allowed the rest of the team to farm out and punish Infernal.
Yeah, that was a little bit rough. I mean, it's good that Infernal had those two goat buttons right at the end to try to fight. Like, that shows spirit, and they wanted to actually try to come back, but it's way too late for that.
Yep, I definitely agree. It was nice to see that they were able to perform the combo. I think if they just did it a little bit earlier in the game, it was still Infernal's chance, because they definitely had the better team fight there. And man, it was such a great back and forth in the beginning. It was so fun to see. It's just when that snowball goes rolling on Nocturne, it's hard to stop it.
Yeah, definitely. And you got to give props to Team Mountain, though. They had, once they got a little bit of a lead, they kept up the vision control in the river. They got their picks, and then they just opened up a couple of turrets and took over the map. Really well played.
Yeah, absolutely. Really love seeing that from out. They had their clear objective in mind from the beginning.
Yeah. Okay, with that, we'll take a small 3-minute break. Just enough time for me to try to set up for a game 2, and then we'll get back into it. And welcome back to game two of this series between Infernal versus Mountain Drake. We saw a clean victory coming out from Team Mountain. What do you expect to see in this next one, Endo?
I mean, if it's anything like game one, don't blink, because at any point in the game, it could swing and just start an avalanche of oppression for Mountain Drake. They definitely are a mountain to deal with when they get the gold onto the right people.
Yeah, definitely. So I think we're just going to get straight back into it, and I will bring up the pick and bans just like the first one. Huh. I mean, this seems a little bit familiar. Not sure if we've seen these before anywhere.
No, it's a weird feeling, a deja vu. But the, it's actually, besides the mid lane, we see a completely different... oh, never mind. I'm speaking incorrectly. But Infernal's bringing a completely different comp to the team. They just didn't like what they had in the first game, I guess.
Yeah, so what do you think about the top lane matchup, the Kled versus Renekton?
Yeah, this matchup is really interesting. It really comes down to skill and playing around the other champion's cooldowns, right? So Kled's W, for those of you who don't know, you can't activate it. When it's off cooldown, he does a lot of damage quickly, and his fourth strike is extra damage. So what Toxic is going to have to do as Renekton is he's going to have to wait for Kled to use that onto the minions, because you have to CS. And then he has to dive in and do the full Renekton combo. And I'm interested to see if Toxic is aware of that weakness of Kled. Because if you go in while Kled's W is up, you lose the trade.
And now on to the jungle. We've seen a little bit of Predator Gragas going around. But can you tell me how that matches up into Vi? Because I know you're a Vi guy.
Oh, yeah. I definitely love my Vi. This one can actually be a tough matchup for Vi, right? Because... Gragas's strength is the belly bump into the barrel smash combo. Vi's only mobility is her main damage, right? With that charge up punch. So you have to choose as Vi, do you believe in yourself to walk out of the way and dodge the belly bump? Or do you use your main form of damage instead of engaging to try and use it as mobility? And then you have to play around that. I don't think Vi wants to meet Gragas in the jungle. I think she wants to be ganking a lot, which we do know Zabel's very good at. And we've seen Zabel's Vi before. And he just put a reckoning on us on Scuttlecrab. So it's going to be up to Unstream to try and to keep her in check while he's burping his way through the jungle.
Yeah. So got a question for you. We know Unstream plays a lot of assassin-type junglers. Do you think his Gragas is going to be more AP-based or more tank-based?
I mean, I want to see full man mode and see the AP based one, but I think for team play, I mean, that's more the solo queue special. I think for his team play, since they don't have that much tank, you do want to put some health on your Gragas so he can survive the dives.
Yeah, and then so for the mid lane, we actually saw this matchup last game, but in reverse. Defox on the Ahri was able to get an early CS lead over Private Sparkle's Malzahar, so we'll have to see if that ends up happening for Private Sparkle.
It's actually going to see who plays the same champion better.
Yeah, and then Private Sparkle did get that solo kill onto Defox's Ahri, though, so I'm wondering if level 6 comes around, Defox can share that pain he felt with Private Sparkle.
Right. It's basically saying, I liked what you did there. Now it's my turn.
Yeah.
So talk to us, too, about this bot lane. Then again, we're seeing the Kai'Sa Morgana, but now it's being turned. It's being responded with the Xayah Lulu.
So I really, really like this Xayah pickup from Coolio. Xayah is a very strong champion right now, has a lot of similarities to the Jhin in the fact that you provide a lot of CC and can stay safe. From range, but you also have that ultimate which turns you untargetable and allows you to escape, well, I guess the Gragas this game, but it would have been the Nocturne as well. And you should be able to have the pushing power with the Xayah over a Kai'Sa Morgana. The Lulu is also a better pickup than the Sona, in my opinion, for that same reason of your ultimate helps you provide defensive stats. so it really negates the dive comp of the Gragas and Kled that are going to be coming straight at you.
Yeah, and I actually have a question too about the bans here. Is it right to left? Like, did Mountain just ban Leo, Nami, Thresh right out the gate?
I believe it's left to right. So the Lucian, Graves, Thresh were first. And then since Timberland didn't pick up a support, the Nami and Leona bans came up next.
You know, I gotta say, I'm a little disappointed by Infernal waiting to draft for Timberland last. I mean, Timberland is a playmaking support. I would have loved to see him on a Nami or a Leo. I'm not as impressed with his Enchanters supports. The man wants to flash and snare. That's his go-to. That's how Infernal has won the games that they have. And it looks like Mountain knows that, and they were targeting him heavily.
Yeah, even his Alistar was very, very strong. And I think, I mean, maybe not the best pick into a Morgana, but it still provides that extra tank that you didn't have last game. So
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, unless Toxic is going to build for Nekted straight tank, which you don't really want to. You want to go like a phage battle or what's that axe item called? It's a phage and Kindle Gem built into it.
The Black Cleaver?
The Black Cleaver. Good Lord. I couldn't even remember. I remember all the components. I can't remember the name of the item. But yeah, you want to make Renekton more of a brawler. So I do agree. I think the Alistar would have been a good pick here.
All right. And with that, let's just get straight into game. So Rec League people, show us if you want Mountain Drake to pull out the 2-0, or put in chat the exclamation point Infernal for Team Infernal taking the 1-1. And I'm ready when you are.
Yep, give us the countdown.
3, 2, 1, let's play.
Yeah, it's going to be great to see the kind of adjustments that they do here. I'm actually really excited to see Infernal just completely changed up their lineup. I hate seeing, like, you know that those champions didn't work last time. I'm just going to try it again because I'm stubborn.
Yeah, and I mean, honestly, the biggest discrepancy was in that top lane between Radizy on the Urgot and Toxic on the Malphite. So we'll have to see. Oh, never mind. We're just going to go for a little invade over here. Rovian and Defox spotted out on that ward, and they end up just backing out. It's a really good ward from, I think that was Private Sparkle.
Yeah, I think it was Timberland who had put it down there. And it's actually really important that they weren't able to clear it, because that's very scary if you don't know if they're in that bush or not. So survive by one life, but that one life is big, and it's going to make Zabel feel a lot safer when he's taking the blue.
Yeah. But as I was saying before, I think Toxic Vezin getting onto more of a comfort pick. I mean, I played with him a lot during Season 1, and he liked to play that Renekton and the Xin Zhao top lane whenever he could.
Really? I was not aware that Renekton was a comfort pick for Toxic. That's so exciting, then. I'm really happy. I'm really looking forward to seeing him bust it out, get some croc up there, and spin that lifeguard gear around.
Yeah, but then again, if he does end up falling behind, he's going to be more useless than a no-farm Malphite.
That's true. That's very true. I'm excited to see Radizy's Kled. I know Radizy's a big Scion player. He's been able to use Scion's ult to great advantage. Kled has a pretty similar ult with that engage, that run-up. So we'll see if he's going to be able to translate it.
And we see the junglers both mirroring each other's movements on this bot side jungle again, but Zabel's able to clear up the Gromp first and go straight for the scuttle grab.
Yeah, and meanwhile Unstream is going to do the red into Krugs and back. Now the reason that he's doing this on Gragas is because he has Predator, and that route lets you take boots right away, so you're not sitting without a keystone for the first 5 minutes of the game.
Zabel is here, though, just sitting in this bot side bush on a ward. He doesn't know he's been spotted, but the way Rovian and Sonic have been playing should tell him that he's on a ward.
this is actually really detrimental, because if he doesn't get something from here, he's wasting so much time, and it negates the Gragas back.
Yeah, and Gragas is going straight for this red buff, getting another three buff onto Zabel.
Brilliant adjustment by Unstream there. That ward just lets him know he gets to run right out. But it looks like Private Sparkle is wise for it. Oh, no, he decides just to go back to lane. Yeah, it looks like Unstream once again is going to three buff Zabel.
And it's a really good gank invade from him, just because Radizy is so shoved up on this Renekton that he's very safe to have his top laner join him if the Vi did end up showing up there.
Yeah. Now, if we look up on the top lane, you can see Kled's axe glowing.
Sorry, bot lane fight going down. Coolio has to flash out. Sonic MMA getting a lot of damage. Greed's out, though. Ends up having to flash out and heal. Lulu gets the first blood without Ignite. Morgana doesn't have any mana, though, and ends up stepping up. Lulu gets the polymorph down, but not enough damage to take him out. Those potions getting chugged.
Nice, great play getting the first blood does go on Timberlake. Oh, big flash onto Morgana. Is not able to seal the deal, and that's actually a bit of a waste. But nice, it gets the, if they're able to shove this on the lane quick enough, it's gonna put Sonic on the back foot. He picks up a Cole, so that Kai'Sa is gonna take even longer to come online. And that's a nice little lead for the bot lane.
And it looks like Toxic ended up dismounting Radizy, but Gragas is here with a Predator. Toxic has no life. Flashes, gets a stun onto the Gragas. Kill goes down, but Gragas is under turret. Zabel goes in, does a little bit of damage, ends up getting a trade kill back. But overall, Zabel and Toxic just get blown up by the Gragas.
Yeah, it's a 2-for-1. Again, Toxic is down 20 CS. By 5 minutes of the game and missing this huge wave, which he's gonna TP back to. The one bright spot, I mean, I know Toxic is a little bit of a lower elo, but you're right, that's a comfort pick for him. That was a clean rotation stun on Gragas under the turret, which allowed at least Zabel to get a return kill.
Yeah, and good job on Zabel for being in the right spot at the right time. It's just a little unfortunate that he took so much damage from the Gragas.
Yeah, and that's that belly bump combo that we were talking about. It's surprising how much damage he can shoot onto you out of nowhere.
One combo rotation from this Kled puts Toxic Vezin down to about a third HP.
Yeah, that's that W passive of Kled. When his axe is glowing, you cannot fight him. You have to wait for him to use it on the minions like he's doing so now. And with that last strike, okay, now you can go in. But Toxic's too low from the previous combo, and he has to just sit under the turret.
Yeah, we see a little bit of a skirmish going off between Zabel and Unstream. Both junglers end up trading a couple of blows, but the bot lane from Mountain roamed up and the mid lane from Infernal roamed down, so they both just walk away.
Yep. And meanwhile, mid lane, we are seeing a pretty even matchup between Sparkle and Defox. Fox is taking actually a lot of damage from these minions, and he's completely out of mana.
Yeah, good gank from Unstream, though. Makes Private Sparkle blow flash, but it looks like it was trade of flashes. Grog is trying to go in for that body slam E, unable to connect it.
For sure, and then, looking a little even right now. Oh, Timberland's going aggressive with this Lulu in the bot lane.
It's something you like to see. And if we track his flash timer, he's got about 2 minutes on that before we see another play from him. But Unstream is here, though.
Yeah,
as the Predator up, is running in.
Predator.
He knows better. Oh, waste the body slam on a minion. He tried to walk by it. And that allows Coolio to walk up and get a trade kill onto Rovian.
I love that aggressive move by Coolio there. I mean, you're probably dead regardless. Most people would run away in fear from the big burping man, but not Coolio. He runs in and he takes down Rovian with him.
Private Sparkle ults over the wall, misses the charm onto Unstream. It's still going in. Vi is here though. Sonic in a very bad spot. Has heal up. Zabel ends up flashing, gets the auto attack. Shield from Lulu saves his life from the last auto tower attack though.
Really, really nice turnaround here from Team Infernal, able to take a gold lead off of that trade. Nice roam from Private Sparkle, just leaving Malzahar, but now D-Fox waiting in the bushes for him.
This might not be good. Coolio is right there. They can take this fight. Malzahar has Splash Up, but he's already rooted up. And that's a kill going over to Coolio GG.
That's even more gold on that Zaya. That's going to start being a pain in the butt for Sonic to deal with in the bot lane.
Yeah, and Sonic once again goes for the BF Sword Cole combo. So it's going to slow down his first item a little bit. Where on Kai'Sa, you really just want to get that out of the way.
Yep. And then unfortunately, Theseus keeps seeing that Radizy's just having his way in top lane. Renekton is going to fall behind. And like you touched on earlier, I mean, Renekton's supposed to be a bully. He's not as good of a champion behind in CS as Malphite is.
But then again, if the Toxic can get one or two items, he's still going to be able to duel this Kai'Sa a little bit, where Malphite would have no chance at that.
Yeah, fair enough. He could just do the double dash in, stun up, and hit Q, and that might be all it needs on Renekton.
Yeah, and I mean, Vi's going to have a lot of damage and a lot of single target CC, so a little bit more damage might be what they need to clear out any of these priority targets. Nice route from Coolio GG onto Sonic, getting down to about half health. It's not a fight that Sonic really wants, so they end up just backing away. Good binding from Rovian to allow him to walk out.
Yeah, I think that's going to be the key to victory here. I would like to see Zabel start camping this bot lane now. It seems that Timberland and Coolio have the advantage in the bot lane, and we got to really push that if on Team Infernal to secure a victory.
I mean, they have the kills, but Coolio ended up getting double longsword boots. So even though he has more attack speed, he doesn't have the damage. Oh, and Sonic walks straight into those feathers. Nice retract from Coolio. And Rovian flashes in place. Might have been a little bit of a misclick there. Good binding comes down on Lulu, though. Flash forward from Coolio. He gets all the damage down. Doesn't even have to retract feathers to get that kill. Really, really good play from Coolio and Timberland.
Hey, the Zaya likes her boots, man. She thinks it's fashionable. She loves proving the casters wrong. Goes ahead and flashes in and finishes and gets that go-ahead from Rovian. Because Coolio saw that misplay by Rovian and knew he didn't have flash, she had the ability to go in and finish it.
Zabel going into the mid lane. Private Sparkle popped Malzahar's spell shield with her ultimate and then just landed an easy charm, which allowed Zabel just to ult and hold the D-Fox in place. Couldn't do anything there.
What they were saying in the locker room, I don't know what kind of pep talk Infernal was having, but it's definitely working. They have a 2k gold lead at 11 minutes right now. Toxic actually is farming better and has an assist. We're seeing the bot lane go out of control, and Private Sparkle again is taking the lead from D-Fox and showing he shouldn't have been an ADC in the previous game. Mid lane's his calling.
Yeah, but I mean, he did get that kill. He does have a little bit of pressure in the lane now. But he's still down 20 CS. Which should put D-Fox and Private Sparkle towards equal gold amounts.
Yeah, that CS game is so important. I know that's absolutely right to bring up. A lot of people, especially in the lower elos, think it's all about kills. But it's really... Oh, go ahead.
We have a teleport come down from Toxic Vezin in the middle of three people. Ults out, but Kai'Sa's being able to put down a lot of damage on him. Black Shield goes onto Rovian, so Sonic M&A gets charmed up, but ults into the Dragon Pit. Fight's going on in all fights. Zaya ends up getting the dragon. Ready Z in the middle of the team, ends up going down, gets dismounted and taken down by Private Sparkle. And then another binding coming out onto the Vi. Vi is charging up Riku, goes in, ults onto D-Fox, flashes onto tower, gets the charm down. D-Fox pops that stopwatch though, so he's staying under turret. Toxic walks forward, stuns him up, but takes a couple of tower shots, ends up going down as well. And in the bot lane, we have more fighting. Coolio taking a little bit of damage from the Sonic MMA, has the ult up, Sonic ends up healing, doesn't really want to walk back through that, might get... Whew. So overall, That was what, a 3-for-1 in favor of Infernal?
Do not blink when watching Infernal and Mountain. Huge plays.
Sonic's dead. Sorry, I couldn't let you talk there. Coolio was making another play.
No, absolutely. He just ran right in. He said he faked the back, which is a great move. Got the speed up from Lulu. And they're going to get first turret.
Yeah, Sonic a little bit greedy there, trying to stay to save this turret. But didn't have enough HP nor support to help him out with that. So he ends up going down.
And I have to give major shout-outs to Toxic Fez in there. It was that heads-up teleport that kicked that game off. If he didn't respond right when he did, Mountain Infernal would have lost that fight. And I think the highlight for me of that huge long fight was when Malzahar had had stopwatched under the turret. Toxic doesn't care. He just sat there and waited.
And he even got binded right next to the stopwatch. So even if he wanted to go anywhere, he had no other choice just to kill the Malzahar.
He's like, this is where I make my stand. He sat there, got binded, and just counted to 4 or counted to 2 for that stopwatch to be done.
Yeah, so definitely better play coming out from Toxic, but still down about 50 CS.
You know, the man's not about his CS. Everyone's got their strengths and weaknesses. He's just a reptile trying to find his way in the jungle.
D-Fox caught out here. The smite takes out the spell shield. And Vi just goes straight in. She gets it pressed up, but Lulu ultimate comes down. Ahri's there, gets a double kill, is now onto Rovian, misses the Q though. And now Coolio is just walking forward, gets binded up, but Lulu shield is on her. Should have enough to walk out. Oh, and the shutdown over to Morgana. Good binding from Rovian to secure that.
Private Sparkle, this is a 5-0 Ahri right now, and he's showing us what he can do with a bit of gold. That is great play. I love the Q got a double kill, killing the Malzahar who had locked down Vi, and the Gragas who just ended up being in the wrong spot.
And once again, that was a 3-for-1 in favor of Infernal. So they're really taking these fights with stride and able to get objectives off of them. This is what you want to see if you're an Infernal fan.
Yeah, that's the big thing. Kills are nice, but you got to turn them into objectives. They have the Mountain Drake, which is going to help with all the future towers. They have the gold lead right now. They're just looking like a completely different team. This is so exciting.
Yeah, and I kind of want to see them pressuring up towards this top side to get this last turret and also the Rift Herald, which will despawn in about 4 minutes.
Coolio just bullying Ratty Z out. He's saying, leave my crocodile friend alone. Seeing how he likes being bullied. And Ratty Z actually is having none of it. I'm still waiting for that big Kled ult from Ratty, though. We know he's a great top lane engager. And I think that's going to be the key to getting Mountain back into this game.
Yeah, we'll have to try to see when that's coming, though. Because right now they have Kai'Sa in the bot lane just almost freezing these minions, but trying to push it up a little bit. Trying to get pressure onto the spot turret. Hopefully they'll be able to take it down if nobody answers, but it looks like Renekton is running straight down there.
He's trying to finish his coal off, which should be done after this wave here. There's that big 350, which can help bring Kai'Sa back into the lane, but now she's backing. She's not even pressuring bot, and it gives Infernal free reign for the Rift Herald or the top tower.
And this might be a little bit greedy from Zabel. Starting up, not knowing where the Kai'Sa is. And Renekton still doesn't have TP for another 30 seconds. Charm comes down onto Rovian, though. Has to flash out. Has the black shield on, but gets picked up by Coolio GG. A really nice play from Private Sparkle there.
Really nice snare. And I got to say, with Timberland speeding up the Xayah, it's terrifying to just see that confidence come in. She's 7-2 right now, and she just runs in, flinging feathers in everyone's face. This is an aggressive Coolio ADC.
Yeah, and Xayah has 2 items completed to the 1 of Kai'Sa. It's a really, really strong champion right now.
Yeah, I mean, we're still waiting to see on... It's definitely an ADC game and mid lane game as opposed to the jungle matchup from game 1 here. And Coolio and Pirate Sparkle just running away right
now. Toxic is getting collapsed on by Unstream. Sonic ends up getting a little bit of plasma on him, ults in. Unstream is here though, able to pick up that kill with the ultimate. And then in the top lane, we see Ratty Z getting caught out. Ends up going down to Coolio. So trade for top laners, which gives Infernal Drake this tower, but it also gives Mountain Drake this Ocean Drake.
Yeah, and they should go for two. I mean, Zabel has the Rift,
and they're going
Ocean
for
Drake
it.
Is definitely not worth that. And look at Private Sparkle, who gives no, you know what.
He just stopped all their backs.
Brilliant, brilliant move by him.
And they can keep pushing on this. If Private Sparkle said that she stopped the backs, this Rift Herald is going to be able to take this inhibitor turret.
Shoot, look how fast Pity is just taking down the turret. That turret's gone. They're pushing for inhib.
A snare does go down onto Coolio, though. Cled out, comes out. Coolio has to ult, gets the snare onto a couple of people, but ends up dying. A chase coming down. Looks like Unstream's a little bit low. Timberland flashes away from good binding.
Yeah, and that flash was the right call there. That binding is going straight on. And there's that Ratty Z ultimate that I was talking about. We got to see a couple more of those plays. Shut down this Zaya. Try and get Mountain back into this game because the roles are completely reversed right now. Mountain is just slowly bleeding a loss.
But they opened up the base with that Rift Herald summon. So with their enormous gold lead, almost 9k right now, they could just shove straight down top if they wanted as five and take that.
Yeah, absolutely. There's nothing here. They can even do this keeping Toxic here and almost using him as bait because one or two show bot. And like you said, it's open top. You just go in and steal that inhib.
And maybe even open Baron at that point.
That's true. We are coming up on the 20-minute mark. Baron will be on the map. That's another objective that Mountain has to worry about. This game has the potential to just get out of their grasp. And you know, I know we were hypercritical of Toxic in the beginning, but look at how he's catching up to the Kled in CS now. He's definitely doing better just splitting off by himself, drawing attention from Mountain.
And that's really what you want as Renekton, right? Just to sit in a side lane and try to bring people to you and try to win that 1v1 duel.
Yeah, absolutely. I see why you said that this is more of a comfort pick than a Malphite for Toxic. This is Croc's jam, man. He just wants to sit, farm, and challenge anyone to a 1v1.
Private Sparkle got caught out a little bit from Sonic, takes a lot of damage, but is able to escape with that with his ultimate. And now it looks like the Mountain's posturing around this, but Zabel's charging up. Doesn't end up going in. Coolio's in the mid lane, though, putting down a good amount of damage onto these minions. But Mountain's able to take that tower down with really good rotation.
Yeah, really, really nicely done getting back into the game. Getting that mid tower down is a big deal. That's actually the first tower of the game.
But with this, Toxic's just been pushing that bot lane. It's up to the turret. And Mountain ends up sending Ratty Z down to Toxic. And I don't know if Toxic's going to be able to take this fight, but it looks like Ratty Z is just going for the minions here.
Look at him. He's making the right choice here. He's walking up to the safety of Timberland and Coolio. Doesn't sacrifice his life. And drawing that attention allows them to push mid.
Yeah, and it gives Zabel enough time to clear out vision around this Baron. So just like Mountain did to Infernal the first game. Oh, we have a Kled ult coming in, going straight for this Lulu. Turns off to the Renekton, is on Coolio. Lulu gets suppressed up, isn't able to ult, gets it off in the last second. A lot of damage getting put down. Sonic gets blown up by his Private Sparkle. Private Sparkle going in for the Morgana, and now onto the Malzahar. Takes out, doesn't end up getting this kill. Timberland's a little low, gotta be careful. But their collapse on the Malzahar and the Kled end up picking those two kills as well. And that's a free Baron.
It was a great idea to press that go button and engage. They just had dumped so much into killing that Zaya because her ultimate allows her to stay alive for so long that Mountain's backline got deleted while Unstream and Ratty Z were able to focus down Coolio.
Yeah, they end up picking up Coolio, which is really good. That's a lot of shutdown gold. But Private Sparkle just played that fight phenomenally. Getting into that back line, just destroying them.
Yeah, I mean, the you don't want the front line over diving like that. the Mal's ult on the Lulu. I don't know. What do you think about that? Would that be?
I think it was okay to keep Lulu in place so she couldn't save Coolio. But at that point, it kind of just, they didn't have enough damage to finish off Coolio. And I don't know, just put Malzahar in a really bad spot for the Ahri to come around. So maybe if it was a little bit better positioning and the Ahri wasn't there, it would have been great.
Sure, I see what you're saying. Yeah, don't let Lulu get the ult out. Perhaps it just came down to communication. Half of the team goes after Coolio, half of the team's going after Timberland, and everyone suffers because of that. And it's just a little unlucky by the Kletter, because you can't actually select who you want to latch onto. It's just whoever the nearest person is. And at the last second, it switched to Toxic's Renekton. And that's not who you want to be headbutting as Kled. Do you want to go after the squishies?
Yeah, and it was originally going straight for Timberland too. So maybe that's where the miscommunication came out.
Yeah, for sure. He was probably calling, like, looks like I'm hitting Timberland. Malzahar goes in, does his job. Here's another Kletel.
And it goes on to Coolio. Coolio gets ulted up by Lulu, putting down a lot of damage. Still has the ult up to stay safe. Malzahar suppressed, comes down onto the Vi, though. A lot of damage getting put traded back. 2-for-2 kill right now. Timberland putting damage onto Sonic. Toxic Vengeance shows up, able to pick up that kill onto Kai'Sa. And it looks like it's just a Malzahar Morgana left alive. A good binding coming out, but they don't have enough damage to be able to step up to this Renekton. This now, turret is going down.
Soul mages against a giant crocodile right now with the Lulu shields, they're not going to be able to stop this push. And you know what? It was a good adjustment. I got to give credit to D-Fox. He understood what he did wrong in the previous fight, and instead of just diving too deep and ulting Desire, who's in the back line, he ulted someone who's a little closer so he could be protected by the Morgana. I do like that adjustment.
Yeah,
unfortunately, they did end up losing the fight, though.
Really chaotic team fights. A lot of damage getting traded back and forth. And once again, you get Coolio, but Private Sparkle still alive, doing so much damage.
Let's take a look at the scoreboard right now. We now, like, the rules have completely reversed. It's 25 minutes in, and Infernal has a 12k gold lead. They're in position to close this game out as they take their marquee dragon.
Yeah, and that's something you really don't want to see if you're a Mountain Drake fan. This Infernal is going to... Oh, Unstream goes over the wall, ults away, ults the other team away. He's able to get back on the other side. Malzahar suppressed coming down onto Renekton, but he's able to walk out as well. A lot of damage being put down from Coolio over the wall. And then Private Sparkle ends up dying to this Ahri. Ahri is still in the fight, going down to Ratty Z. Lulu picks up that kill. And a 4-for-2... No, a 4-for-1 in favor of Infernal, and this game is just over with that fight.
Ooh, nice rotation by Toxic killing the Kai'Sa. This literally went in Mountain's favor that fight. It was a clean engage. They were able to split up Infernal, but the gold lead was just too big for Infernal, and Mountain paid the price for it, and it looks like they're going to try and close it out.
Yeah, and I mean... Unstream is up in 1 second, though, so he might be able to stop this. Coolio is turning off just to take this top lane inhibitor, and Renekton is pushing in this bot wave, and they might try to turn onto this bot lane out inhibitor turret, take that down.
Private Sparkle is 9-0 on his Ahri. Look at his item build right now. He's just too far ahead. Level 15. While Unstream and Ratty Z are two levels below, these guys should be at least on par.
He went second item Hextech Gunblade on Ahri. Just getting that extra burst damage.
I love it. It's a great move, right? When you're that far ahead, you don't want them to get the shutdown, so you get the healing from your massive Q damage. You get that Gunblade proc to just delete your enemies, and now he's got a Zhonya's. I don't know if this Ahri's ever going to see a gray screen.
Maybe not this game. It doesn't look like we have much of a game left to play, honestly. So
yeah,
maybe.
this has been quite a stop. I mean, one more fight and Infernal can close it out. We have to see something big from Mountain here. We gotta see them. I think team fights are out of the question. I think you gotta start looking for picks. Use the Kled ult to run it down when someone's isolated and just slowly get gold back into your pocket, because you're far ahead.
And we actually see him in their jungle. They're picking up a little bit of vision. They might try to use these pockets just to get some picks on Infernal.
Yeah, but it's a good move for them. It seems like they know right now that they're like what I had just said, you gotta look for the pick.
But they end up backing out of their jungle and just giving away the vision. So the past minute they spent in there, they just give it straight up and don't go for a pick.
And look at Coolio. Look at this ADC just running down, saying, I'm the front line now. I'm too far ahead to care.
Yeah, he finished up his fourth item, gets that Mercurial Scimitar. A nice binding coming down onto him, though. Ends up cleansing out. Ratty Z is in the middle of the team, but he ends up taking a lot of damage. Now it's a 5v5. The ADC is full health, but both top laners are down to half. And these minis getting traded back. Nice ult over the wall onto Rovian. This Ahri doesn't have enough damage to finish it, though. And just like that, Private Sparkle takes his first death of the game.
950 gold shutdown. He wasn't able to proc the Zhonya's because he was just too weak. Cast his curse, strikes again. I'm so sorry, Private Sparkle. You could put the blame on me.
Yeah, the Malzahar Express went down almost immediately as he went over the wall. But the amount of damage coming down was insane from that Ahri.
Yeah, that was some nuclear cues over there. He was so close to just styling on them. But I think he just got too big for his bridges. But meanwhile, well, this has happened. That's a lot of super minions in Mountain's face.
Yeah, Mountain will be able to clear that up, though. But that does mean Infernal's going to have free reign over this Baron.
And you know what? Can we touch on how different Toxic looks on a Renekton? Look at him right now, 4-3-7, keeping up in CS, he's actually out-leveling Ratty Z. I don't think he should be on Malphite ever again. Let the man have his croc.
Let the man have his croc, indeed. So, Infernal did a good job of getting vision, but they missed this one little blue trinket, which has been spotting him the entire time. I'm sorry, yellow trinket. And now that they clear the blue, they just go straight for Baron. Private Sparkle is back with the team, though. So we'll have to see if Kled ends up TPing in. They look like they're going to go for this fight. Private Sparkle 7-4, though, gets the charm onto the Kai'Sa, almost one-shots him. Coolio is able to step up, get that kill. A lot of fighting going down. Private Sparkle in the middle, takes out the Gragas. Ratty Z is on the backside, though, tries to go in for Coolio, flashes forward, ends up dying, though, unable to get that kill. And that's a 4-0 in favor of Infernal.
That's not just 4-0. That's the game. I don't know any Morgana right now that can hold this off. I don't care who you are. This is looking like a big Infernal comeback, which is so huge because they were just so defeated from game one. I had already written them off, but they have so much heart. Infernal was fighting for their playoff lives, and they're not going down quietly. They're here to win the Rekt League and the series. Great job, Infernal.
Yeah, that was absolutely explosive. So it was kind of the complete opposite of the first game.
It's unbelievable, man. I'm so excited. I love seeing the comeback. So many times people get in their own heads there and just get depressed and beaten down. But Mountain smacked the crap out of Infernal. Let's be honest, in game one, Infernal went into the locker room. They had their big hype up talk and they said, no, we're here to win, and they came back just as strong.
And Max probably said, hey, guys, trust me. Let me play the croc.
Give me the crocodile.
And Private Sparkle just doing some insane amount of work on that Ahri pick.
Oh, my God. That was just – he was just blowing people up. The whole team, I just love the complete turnaround. I love this. This is such a great back-and-forth series.
Yeah,
is anyone on? Would we be able to interview anyone?
Let us just ask the Rekt chat. Hey, anybody from Team Mountain and Team Infernal in the chat, if you want to come in for an interview, now's the time.
Speak it up, boys, because we got to talk to you about that fiery, fiery back and forth. And there's a little bit of a caster delay, so we'll have to see.
Yeah, wait a couple minutes.
Yeah. Well, that's going on. Turtle Lake. What What's your character name?
Are jump into Discord under Zombie Team, and we can drag you in.
Unstream.
Oh, unstream. Hell yeah.
Let's get him in here. Let's talk about that
game. Oh, yeah, that Nocturne game. Oh,
whew. Drag you in.
Unstream.
Oh, unstream. Hell yeah.
Hey. Would you mind muting the stream while we're doing this?
Oh, yeah, that Nocturne game. Oh,
oh, whoops, my bad.
Nah, it's all right.
So Unstream, welcome to the after chat. Give us your thoughts on that series, just right out of the gate. What are you thinking?
Like the first one with Nocturne, like it's been a big comfort pick for me almost. So like being able to like win that felt really, be able to play that felt really good. And then the second game, like we drafted a comp that like the win condition was to sort of like dive in and like pretty much just run at them and win. But like they just got a huge lead and like we tried getting back into it, but like it just wasn't ever working out for us. They played really well, so
yeah, that your Nocturne I could definitely tell was a comfort pick. At what point did you start losing your fear and realize you can go wherever you want and nuke people?
It's like pretty much after I pick up that like double kill bot lane, once in your 3-0, it's just, you know,
literal lights out.
Yeah. So, I see Zabel's up there. I don't know if you want to drag him in.
Oh yeah, for sure. We got to talk.
Yeah,
about
let's go.
This jungle matchup we had going here.
So one more question on stream. I guess this is kind of for both of you. Welcome Zabel, by the way.
Yo.
Same thing. Would you mind muting the stream while we're doing this? But my question basically is, so you two early game pretty much mirrored each other both games throughout a laning phase the entire time. Did you two know where each other were? Did you study each other's movements and try to mirror that? Or were you mainly just going off of your normal pathing?
I think we had pretty good vision control to see, but a lot of the times, I mean, watching the stream just now, we just ended up in the same spot at the same time. I mean, I guess I just, the way their bot lane sets up for ganks, it looks like they're going to be going in. So I try to make my way that way. I mean, he could probably say the same.
All right, you can try to take it off.
Yeah, on stream. So what were your thoughts on how you guys kept colliding on with each other with the ganks?
I think there was like some where we were able to sort of like, because he kept on trying to do that like level 2 gank bot, that kind of let us know where he was. And then after he either got the kill or it didn't pan out, we knew he was going to be on the top side, which like let me pretty much always get that triple buff start. And then, After I walked, like after that, like I just knew he was probably going to be farming his top side. I told Ratty Z to like watch out because he was shoving in a lot. So just make sure to always like hang around there for the early game. But,
yeah, that was great heads up adjustments there. Just being able to predict the pathing. So Zabel, you've been playing a huge array of champions in this league, but you seem most comfortable on Vi. Is that your pocket pick?
I'm gonna say no just to keep the fear in the other teams. yeah, I'm gonna say no. I'm gonna be pulling out some new stuff, so I'm looking forward to it.
Awesome. Darted, questions?
Yeah, so Zabel, can you tell us a little bit about the round 2 draft? What made you guys take the Ari away from D-Fox, and what prompted the Renekton pick instead of the Malphite?
Well, for that, I'll just talk about the round 1 draft real quick. So we knew that D-Fox played a lot of Malzahar, and we wanted to just pick that away as kind of another ban against him. But game 2, Nico said he doesn't have a problem with Malzahar, and he felt comfortable playing the Ari into it, I guess because he had trouble with that game 1. Huge part of our draft there was trying to ban out Unstream with those diving champions. So that was something we thought would work pretty well because he got so ahead on that Nocturne game 1. We wanted to kind of try to counter around that with the Lulu.
Awesome. And can you tell us a little bit about, because we were talking about Toxic's change in performance from game one to game two. Tell us about that Renekton.
Renekton's one of his OG mains. I mean, he did pretty well early in the season with Malphite, so we kind of just, afterthought, just stuck him on Malphite. But, it turned out that if he's going to be behind in farm, as is typical, I mean, you guys have seen that. We decided it's probably better to put him on a champion that doesn't suffer as much being behind in farm in the side lane.
Smart and adjustment. He really turned it around.
Yeah, he played super well in that second game. I was super proud of him.
Yeah. Totally different champion. Totally different player in that second game.
I will say I like the fact that the mid lane matchup reversed. I felt like seemed like a pretty strong pick against the Malzahar in both games. So.
Yeah, now when I go in solo queue and just start claiming that Ari automatically counters Malzahar, I have you guys to blame. I don't know if that's true or not, but that's in my head.
All right, and with that, thank you very much for joining us. Those were very exciting games to watch. I think we had more than a kill per minute each game, which was crazy.
They were a lot of fun to play.
Yeah, so GG's to you both. And that, I think, wraps up the standings for this week. So if you guys want to go ahead and check out where each of the teams are, go over to rektleague.com. No the in front of that. And remember to like, follow, subscribe to our Twitch, YouTube, and you can follow us on Instagram and Twitter and all that jazz. Thank you very much, Endo, for joining me for this cast.
Always a pleasure. Thank you, Dark Dad.
And we'll see the rest of you in Twitch chat on next Sunday.